Very good evening to all of you. A diya can be used for lighting many other diyas, causing several fold increase in brightening a room without losing its strength. Similarly, we are all here today to share knowledge about our own culture with each other, which may increase our understanding and a sense of caring without diminishing one's own knowledge. So on behalf of Vivekananda Institute of Indian Studies, Swami Vivekananda Youth Movement, I would like to wish a very happy Diwali to all of you present here. As most of you know, we at VIS have been conducting programs to promote and facilitate the development and dissemination of Indian culture, spirituality, arts, music and the like, besides offering customized courses in the context of India. And our organization, SVYM, is a development organization engaged in building a new civil society in India through its grassroots to policy level action in health, education and community development sectors. So let's begin today's interaction on one of India's biggest and popular festivals, Deepavali. As you know, we have like-minded distinguished panelists with us now, who will share their own and one of the perspectives of celebrating Deepavali. I would like to welcome Mr. Sudarshan, faculty at Vivekananda Institute of Indian Studies, Dr. Sridevi Sitaram, consultant pathologist at Vivekananda Memorial Hospital and Sigma Hospital, Mysore, Dr. Anant Ardhyam, a house surgeon at Vanivilas Hospital, Bangalore, Dr. Sitaram, consultant orthopedic surgeon at Vivekananda Memorial Hospital, Swami Vivekananda Youth Movement, and Ms. Bhargavi, again a faculty at Vivekananda Institute of Indian Studies. So the attempt is to keep this interaction as informal as possible. This means we are open to receive your views from the beginning of the session, but of course through the chat box to keep up with the time. Participants who would like to speak will have time by the end of the speaker's talk. So that's the plan. I think without any more delay, I will now hand over to Mr. Sudarshan for setting the context of today's webinar and also to give us some glimpses on celebrating Deepavali.
Thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you very much, Dr. Rekha, and good evening to all my dear friends. I would like to start with sharing a small வீடியோ கிளிப்பிங்.
அவர் வந்து அந்த காலத்துல எம்பிபிஎஸ் படிச்சுட்டு அந்த அந்த ஜெனரல் சேவை கழி போயிட்டாங்க. அங்க
இன்சே
கர் ரோஷன் கர்தே தும் ஜித் கர்கே பார் பார் தோ தியே ஜாதா லியா கர்தே தே
ஹேப்பி திவாலி
அரே லல்லா जब तक ये सब बिक ना जाए काहे की हैप्पी दिवाली। अरे तू रहन दे लल्ला, अब तू मेरी छोड़, खुश है ये ले ये दो रखते।
थैंक यू अम्मा, और आप फिकर मत कीजिए, सारे दिए बिक जाएंगे। बाय।
इसी आस की मुक्ति लेकर मैं आशा के दिए बनाता हूँ। मैं इसी
बजाऊंगा
अरसे बाद वो आज फिर यहाँ आया है। सालों बाद उसने इन दीयों को गले लगाया है। बुझ गई थी उम्मीद की जो आखिरी मशाल, इस दिवाली किसी ने उस अंधेरे में एक हल्का सा दिया जलाया।
अम्मा दिए?
अरे अब एक भी दिए ना बच्चे लल्ला।
कहा था ना अम्मा सारे दिए बिक जाएंगे।
इस दिवाली आप भी उम्मीद का एक दिया जलाएं, किसी और की दिवाली को भी रोशन बनाएं। हैप्पी दिवाली। नोट हजार, तुम निकले भरी दुपहर।
Although this video has been widely circulated in the WhatsApp, I thought even as watching over and over again. I think it's a wonderful way, especially for an organization like us, to wish you all a very, very happy and prosperous Deepavali. Yeah, I'm going to start my presentation. I've got a few slides. Shubham Karoti Kalyanam Arogyam Dhanasampada Shatru Buddhi Vinashaya Deepa Jyotir Namostute. I salute to the light which brings auspiciousness, prosperity, good health, and the destruction of the intellect's enemy. Well, friends, Deepavali is celebrated across India and, of course, many other countries with pomp, gaiety, and splendor, which include Sri Lanka, Nepal, Indonesia, Malaysia, Fiji Islands, and so on. Actually, Deepavali is a combination of two words in Kannada, as we say, Deepa plus Avali, which connotates as, you know, lamps multiplying itself or lamps lit in rows. And now what exactly we do on these 5 days of the celebrations, I go one by one. The day one is we celebrate it as Dhanteras, also known as Dhanvantri Trayodashi. As a prelude to Deepavali, homes are thoroughly cleaned up, cleansed and painted, usually whitewashed as they are done in villages. And specifically on this night, sky lamps and lanterns are lit. Clay lamps, diyas are placed near the tulsi plant and in front of the main door to welcome Goddess Lakshmi. And of course, it is a sort of a prelude to the next few days of celebrations that are to follow. The second day is Choti Diwali, also known as Naraka Chaturdashi. Hindu literature narrates that the demon Narakasura was killed on this day by Sri Krishna and Satyabhama. Of course, what exactly we do on this day? We get up early in the morning, although for a change for many of us, and take the head bath or the Abhyanga Snan with sesame oil, which is considered auspicious early in the morning. It is also believed that those who are into Tantra, the learning tradition, start learning their mantras on this day. As the evening approaches, wearing new clothes, sweets and special dishes are partaken with family and friends. The evening fireworks are set up in an atmosphere of joyful fun. Houses are lit up with oil lamps during the evening, and the celebrations are off to a fine start for the second day. The third day is celebrated as Lakshmi Puja, also known as Diwali Puja, the Bandi Chor Divas, and the Diyari. Goddess Lakshmi, the goddess of wealth, prosperity, and good fortune, visits her devotees and bestows blessings on this day. The day is also celebrated differently by different traditions, especially in the Sikh tradition. It is celebrated as Bandi Chor Divas, or the Day of Liberation. On this day, Guru Gobind Singh was released from prison by the Mughal Emperor Jahangir, along with 52 captive Hindu kings. It is usually celebrated with the lighting of the lamps at homes and gurudwaras, feasts, giving gifts, and family time. Diyari is yet another way of celebrating Diwali. It is a Sindhi celebration of Diwali with their own customs, especially worship of their shops along with Goddess Lakshmi. As we approach the fourth day, which is celebrated as Balipadyami or Govardhana Puja, Balipadyami or Bali Pratipada commemorates the annual return of King Mahabali to the earth and the victory of Vamana, one of the incarnations of Vishnu in the Dashavatara. Once again, after the ceremonial oil bath, people wear new clothes, the door or the gate entrance of homes are decorated with rangolis and the images of Bali with his wife Vidyavati. To celebrate this festival, devotees also worship Lord Krishna as Govardhana Giridhari. In the evening, the door sills of every house is lit with lamps arranged in rows, sweets exchanged with neighbors, and lighting fireworks, that too, in communion, lighting fireworks along with neighbors with all that fun and with all that pomp and gaiety is there on this day too. As I go to the fifth day celebrations are known as the Bhai Dooj. It's also known as the Bhau Beej in Maharashtra, the Bhatru Dvitiya, the Bhai Pota in Bengal, and so on. The celebration of Bhai Dooj is similar to the festival of Raksha Bandhan. And how exactly it is celebrated, the how of it will follow a little later. Yes, friends, Deepavali or Diwali celebrations don't end here, they continue. After a lull, after 8 days, in fact, the Kartikai Deepam in Tamil Nadu and the Tulsi Puja in Karnataka and Andhra are celebrated on the full moon day, the Paunami on the 12th day after Lakshmi Puja or the new moon day. The Kartikai Deepam or the Brahmotsavam festivities at Tiruvannamalai, the Arunachaleshwara Swami Temple, Tamil Nadu are considered most sacred. These are some of the slides where you would really know the what of it. I would like to leave you with a few images and impressions. The first one is the image of Lord Vishnu as Dhanvantari, bringing us all health and prosperity. The second one is the effigy of Narakasura. Usually these effigies are burnt in Goa. Third one, the Vamana Avatara. And the fourth one is the Lakshmi Puja, also known as the Diwali Puja. In fact, the photograph of Ganesha, the Lakshmi and Saraswati worship together. In fact, it is symbolic of the Diwali Puja itself. And the last one is that of the lamps being lit during the Kartika Deepam festival. These are some of the images and impressions, but most importantly, the memories. I think we are all, you know, have our own wonderful childhood memories. And what are memories without crackers in the Deepavali? And the photograph to your top right, if I ask you a simple question amongst all my friends, how many of us have done this? And there'll be a, I'm sure there'll be a unanimous response. We would have played with all types of permutations and combinations with our sparklers. In fact, going up to rehearsing our signatures too sometime later. And then we have the two photographs below, the lamps being lit in Ayodhya as a part of Deepavali. And the last photograph to the right is one more significant memory that I have. In fact, I was speaking to one of my colleagues in the morning where TTK, as a company, they used to organize this firework display in the cricket stadium in Bangalore for about 4 to 5 years. And we had the opportunity to go there and witness the spectacle for a couple of years. So that spectacle looks like the photograph that I have shared with you to the right there. Yeah. Memories are there, and the making of this particular sky lantern and Akashaputti is very special for me, dear friends. The first two photographs are the recent ones. I want to really talk about the last one to the right, where the making of this sky lamp or the sky lantern itself was a weak affair for all of us, all of my friends. We used to really make these lamps for about 15-20 homes and take up 1 week for the entire process, and colorful ones. And when we were ready with these lamps, it was very intriguing and interesting that it should be placed in a way that it is quite beyond the the ceiling or the terrace. So the bamboos were brought in, and we used to balance them. Some of them were tied to the trees, and of course with all the lights within. So these are some of the memories which I for one would cherish forever. I am sure that all of you have got wonderful such memories with you of celebrating Deepavali. I would now stop sharing the screen, and of course my colleague Bhargavi is raring to go, and she wants to give us some of her insights and glimpses into the symbolism of the why of it, the symbolism of why we celebrate Deepavali and so on. And of course all of us could share many more such memories as we progress on in this webinar. So over to my colleague Bhargavi. Bhargavi, it's all yours. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Before Bhargavi begins, we have a sharing by Ms. Sujata Ashok that Akash candle in different shapes lit up outside every house ushers the festive occasion. So, yeah, Bhargavi, yeah, you can take over now. Yeah.
Namaste, everyone. Asatoma Sadgamaya, Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya, Mrityorma Amritangamaya. From the unreal, lead me to the real. From the darkness, lead me to the light. From death, lead me to immortality. This is the prayer from Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Light symbolizes knowledge, and when we don't have to run away from the darkness, all we need to do is light a lamp, or maybe switch on a light in the modern context if we speak. So Deepavali, the festival of lights, symbolizes victory of good over evil and light over darkness. Even the victory of Rama after winning the battle with Ravana, it is also celebrated as Deepavali. People welcomed Lord Rama by lighting lamps when he returned to Ayodhya, and that continued as the celebration of Diwali. So sunlight, which nurtures all the living beings on this earth. So light is essentially the very source of life. It signifies clarity. So Deepavali, which we celebrate by lighting lamps in our homes, It is not just about lighting lamps outside. It is about bringing that inner light to ourselves. Whereas whatever we have gathered within us, all the darkness, which is habits or the emotions or our judgments, which actually blocks us from showing our true potential, that itself is this symbolic of lighting lamps, which is actually which creates a very positivity wherever we are. And as we celebrate Deepavali, so likewise the celebration has to be into our own lives. So where each activity, every aspect of life is celebrated, not just for these days, but each day. Maybe when we go to work, or the simple act of eating food, or any activity which can be done with joy and with the thought of celebration, it symbolizes that. Moving on to Naraka Chaturdashi. Chaturdashi is the 14th day of the month. And when Narakasura was killed by Lord Krishna, so he was very powerful. He was born out of Vishnu and Bhudevi. So he had this boon. Apart from his mother, nobody can't kill him. So, and he actually waged war against Indra. He wanted to conquer Indra's kingdom, and he had held many women in his captive. So there was no end to the atrocities caused by Narakasura. So Krishna, along with Satyabhama, went to Pratjyotisha. It is modern Assam. He was the ruler of Pratjyotishapura. And he first killed Mura, who was the general of Naraka. That is why Krishna has the name Murari. Mura is supposed to be the most powerful warrior. He had some magical powers, and nobody was able to destroy the fortification. Krishna kills Mura, and later on he was able to reach to Naraka. So at the time of when his last time comes, Naraka actually realizes that he has spent all his life doing nothing, and it was all waste when Krishna comes, and he repents his actions. So he requests Krishna that this day has to be celebrated, not because you are killing me, but you are actually killing the wrongs done by me. So this has to be celebrated as a day for killing of all the wrongs that is within us. So this is the time for elimination of negativity. So for Narakasura, Krishna had to come to make him realize. But for all of us, we don't have to wait until our death. So we can actually be the persons whom we always want to be right away. All those smaller changes which we can make in our daily lives. So this is the time for self-introspection. Maybe getting up 1 hour early than what we usually get up. Practicing more, not taking our time for granted. All this, all the small changes, which are a small habit of ours, which keeps us binded. If we can actually break all this, it will bring a lot of positivity into our lives. So this is the symbolism of Naraka Chaturdashi. So killing of all the wrongs, or elimination of all that unwanted or whatever we have piled up. This is the time for that. And Lakshmi Puja. Lakshmi is the goddess of wealth and prosperity. And during the Samudra Manthana, churning of the ocean, after Shiva drinks the halahala poison, she comes after that, even before Dhanvantari or Amrita comes into existence. So there itself we can understand how special Lakshmi is. So Lakshmi visits houses which are clean, which are well kept in place. So she doesn't visit the houses which are not clean. So this symbolizes well-being, the worship of Lakshmi itself. Well-being, not only economic well-being, but both physical, mental, and spiritual well-being. So if we keep our house clean, our health, it will be all right. We'll be physically well. And when we can physically, when we are physically fit, we can think right. And if we think right, and if we have the right action, definitely we will get prosperous. So the Lakshmi, she holds lotus in her two hands. So one is full blown, which symbolizes again spiritual sadhana, and the other is not completely blown. It is just a bud. So it symbolizes the three gunas. Even the lotus has three shades: rajas, tamas, and sattva guna. So if we think right, if we act right, then nobody can't stop us from having Lakshmi. Bali Padyami. Bali is again a Puranic king. He was very powerful. He is the grandson of Prahalada and son of Virochana. He was an ardent devotee of Vishnu, but again, he also desired the position of Indra. So that is why Vishnu had to take up the avatar of Vamana, and takes the incarnation of Vamana. Vamana is a dwarf. This is how Vamana is depicted in most of the temples. He is, threading ceremony, he goes for Bhikshatana, and he goes to the kingdom of Bali, and he asks him, "Can you give me 3 footsteps of land?" And Bali says, yes, definitely. And Vamana keeps his first feet in the sky and the second feet in the earth. So almost everything is covered. And Bali realizes that the person who can grow up this big, it can't be anybody else other than the Vishnu himself. And he surrenders himself and he asks, "Keep your third feet on my own head." And then Vishnu pushes him to the Patala or the netherworld. So here again, it shows the elimination of ego. Though he was involved in all those desires, in the end he realized, and he surrenders himself, and he realizes that you are above me, so I am bowing my head, and you can, that itself shows. And the very fact that Bali Padyami or Naraka Chaturdashi is still, see, Bali, the names of these kings are, even today it is celebrated. It is not in Krishna's name or Vishnu's name or Vamana's name, but their own names. So it shows that no matter whosoever does what, once if they realize, we have to value and respect the goodness in others. And Bali or Naraka can be found in anybody. Bali can be within us. We can also desire something, maybe of the position or anything. But the once we fall down, the fall will be very big, no matter how good the person is. So always we have to keep on introspecting ourselves. Where are we? Where are we? Where are we? What do we? So this is the symbolism of Vamana or Bali Padyami. I wish you all a very, very happy and prosperous Deepavali. May this festival bring peace, harmony, and light. So from this festival, hope we all of us can introspect ourselves, and maybe whatever, however way we can improve ourselves to the best of who we are. So let us just bloom wherever we are placed. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Balu.
Now I hand over to Dr. Sridevi. She'll be talking about customs and traditions of Diwali. Over to you, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you, Bhargavi, and a very warm good evening to all the participants, and advance wishes for a happy Diwali to all of you. It's a pleasure to join this panel discussion because this has implied a sharing of the various customs and traditions that are followed in India to celebrate Diwali. We always know that India is a very diverse country with so many languages and so many religions, castes, creed, and Diwali is not left behind, right? So Diwali also shows a lot of diversity in the way it is celebrated across our country and also in the neighboring countries. So I'll start my presentation by sharing my screen. So I'll be talking about the customs and traditions of Deepavali. I'm sure we are having a lot of experience within our group of the audience because we have participants from all over the country. And there are many similarities in the way we celebrate Deepavali because the common theme is the theme of lighting clay lamps everywhere. But at the same time, there are subtle differences and varieties in the way the festival is celebrated. But the underlying theme of every observation is that like Deepavali symbolizes a spiritual victory of light over darkness, good over evil, and knowledge over ignorance. We'll see that this is a running theme in the way we celebrate the festival. A quick recap at what my two panelists have said already, that just to locate how the festival in the Vikram Samvat lunar calendar of India, the Diwali straddles the transition of the Ashvina Masa into the Kartika Masa. So the midpoint is the Amavasya day or the new moon day, which is celebrated as Lakshmi Puja. And the two preceding days are the Dhanteras and the Narata Chaturdashi. And the two subsequent days are the Balipadyami and the Yamadvitiya. So these are the 5 days of Deepavali, which are also commonly called as the Pancha Parva of Diwali. Now day one, as we all know, is Dhantrayodashi. Dhan meaning wealth and Trayodashi referring to the 13th day of the Ashvija Masa. So this festival celebrates the emergence of Lakshmi during the Samudra Manthan. And Lakshmi is a kind of a very popular goddess because she represents wealth, and who doesn't like money? But wealth is not necessarily monetary wealth or material wealth. It could also refer to spiritual wealth. It all depends upon the person who is looking at it and his or her inclinations and aspirations. The Dhantrayodashi is actually preceded by extensive cleaning over days. I remember when I was living in North India, we had staff taking off for a week from their work because they wanted to clean up their house. So it is a very important aspect of preparation for Diwali. And the connotation to this is not merely to make the house look nice and welcoming to the guests, but also it is believed that when you remove clutter and stuff that you don't use in the house out, it is like taking away the negative energy. Clutter is equivalent to negative energy. The Lakshmi Puja is usually done in the Pradosh Kal. The Pradosh Kal is the period after sunset, and so that is when the Lakshmi Puja is done. Dhantrayodashi Lakshmi Puja is a little different from the Lakshmi Puja done on the Amavasya day. On Dhantrayodashi, Lakshmi is worshipped along with Ganesha first, followed by Kubera, who is the god of wealth, and Dhanvantri, who is the god of Ayurveda. Both Lakshmi and Dhanvantri actually emerged during the Samudra Manthan. Lakshmi was one of the first deities to emerge out of the Samudra Manthan. And Dhanvantri was probably the last because he came with the nectar or the Amrita, which gave immortality. Immortality is not merely the longevity in terms of mere lives, but it's also the immortality that you attain liberation from the cycle of births and rebirths, when we attain the spiritual awareness or consciousness. In South India, particularly in Karnataka, Dhantrayodashi or the Trayodashi day is also celebrated as a Neeru Tumbuva Habba. That means you're filling water. It's also called as Jalapurna Trayodashi. So here we see pictures. This is the first picture is from the Udupi Pejavar Mutt. This was when the Pejavar Swamiji was still alive. So the water in the large cauldron, which is used to heat water for bath, is decorated with flowers and mango leaves. And the water is venerated by mantras and pujas. The water is regarded as Ganga, and the water that emerges after the puja is regarded as Gangajal. On the right panel, you see a water cauldron, a water drum. You must have seen this in many traditional homes. This is made of copper, because copper is regarded as a very good element to store water. And the way, here you can see puja done to the drum. And water is stored here. And this is kind of preparation for what happens on the next day, that is the Naraka Chaturdashi. So day 2 of Diwali is the Naraka Chaturdashi, or the day 14 of the Aswija month. Bhargavi already told you that this day denotes the killing of Narakasura by Sri Krishna and Satyabhama. The legend goes that after he killed Narakasura, Krishna smeared Narakasura's blood on his forehead. And because of the very prolonged and vicious battle that he had with Narakasura, his entire body was smeared with dirt and blood and dust and everything. So when he returned home in the early hours on the morning of Chaturdashi, his wives and all the female attendants in the palace received him and gave him a very elaborate cleaning and ritualistic bath. So the rituals that we follow on Naraka Chaturdashi are kind of reenacting this whole happenings of what happened many, many eons ago. So what we do, we wake up at the crack of dawn, usually at 3 or 4 a.m. in the morning, and we burst crackers. And crackers would be something that would create a lot of noise, like a atom bomb or a hydrogen bomb or something like that. So that denotes the killing of the asura. So all of us would be like Krishnas and Satyabhamas, we who killed Narakasura. And then we return home, and then there's a ritual of a abhyanga and a snana, which is a very elaborate process. So these are usually the components of the abhyanga. You can see this platter with kumkum and haldi. So the kumkum is smeared on the forehead, denoting the happening that Krishna that happened to Krishna when he smeared the demon's blood on his forehead. In the cup in the center, you see some coarse powder. This is a snana churna or a uptan. Uptan is usually a mixture of like natural ingredients like besan and black gram or green gram powdered. It could be mixed with some Ayurvedic herbs like manjishta or haldi, sandalwood. These are all substances which help in exfoliation and cleansing the skin, and many of them even have antiseptic properties. You have that coarse brush or a scrub at the top, which is made of the uttiveru, they call it, or couscous grass, the roots of the couscous grass, and that is used to scrub the powder off the body. The powder or the churna is usually made into a paste using milk, which is mixed with rose water essence or rose petals, which gives it the fragrance and the fragrance. So, but before all this, the body is anointed or massaged with til or sesame oil or even castor oil. So this was a very regular ritual. You can see this boy sitting on a wooden platform, or a mane we call it in Kannada, which has a rangoli painted on it. And the boy has already been has received the kumkum or the tilak on his forehead. And his mother is smearing oil all over his body or giving the abhyanga. Following this, his body will be smeared with the churna paste, and then he's going to have a very nice hot water bath. So the churna that is used has many connotations. One is that we are reenacting the rituals that happened to Krishna. At the same time, the churna has a lot of medicinal properties. This churna is also used when the bride and the bridegroom get ready for their wedding. And it is supposed to make the skin very beautiful and glowing. The Naraka Chaturdashi day is also the day when the bride and the bridegroom celebrate it as their first Diwali after marriage. So they collect either in the bride's parents' place or in the in-laws' place, and then all the extended family is invited over, and the house is decorated with colorful rangolis and lamps. It's a very festive air. There's a very important social angle to this. When the bride and the bridegroom come there, either to a parent's house or with the in-laws, there's a nice opportunity for them to meet with everybody. Maybe the brother-in-laws, they kind of brothers-in-law, they bond together, or they sit with the father-in-law and discuss politics. or maybe a favorite cricket game or a football game. So these are kinds of icebreakers, and maybe the daughter-in-law will get a chance to show off her culinary skills to her mother-in-law. It's a good opportunity for everybody to get together. In South India, you have this very traditional meal that is served on a banana leaf, and you can see the Puran Poli also there. Yeah, this is a signature dish of Deepavali and almost all parts of South India and a good part of Western India also. We call it Holige or Obbattu. It is called Puran Poli in Maharashtra and other areas, which is a very delectable sweet. The third day is the Lakshmi Puja again. While the Lakshmi Puja on Dhanteras is celebrated as the Udbhava of Lakshmi from the Samudra Manthan, the Lakshmi Puja on the Amavasya day is regarded as just a puja to welcome Lakshmi into people's homes. It is said that on this day, on the day of Amavasya, Lakshmi roams the earth and she's looking at her homes of devotees, and she chooses the cleanest and the brightest home to enter first. So people are very anxious to clean up their house and light it up with a lot of colorful lamps and lanterns, and the elaborate puja is done and a kalasha is made ready to receive the goddess into their home. So it is said that Lakshmi prefers the cleanest and the brightest houses to visit. This puja is usually combined with the Kubera puja because Lakshmi, the goddess of wealth, and Kubera, the treasurer, they go together. So in Punjab, this day is also celebrated as Bandi Chor Divas, not actually directly related to Diwali, because it is mostly because Guru Hargobind, the sixth guru, was released from jail today on that day by Jahangir. The Sindhis celebrate this day as Diari. So there are different names and different ways of celebrating the day. There are a lot of social aspects to Lakshmi Puja. After the puja is over, that is when the bursting of crackers and the fireworks and all start. It is also an opportunity for relatives to visit each other, friends to visit each other. There's a lot of exchange of gifts, sweets. And in some Jain communities and business communities, this marks the end or closure of the financial accounts of the previous year. And on the next day, the new accounts start. They don't follow the regular Gregorian calendar's financial year. This is a very auspicious day, and many people like to make down payments on purchase of a house or a car or something. They don't do Gruha Praveshas on this day, but it is said that if you make a down payment or decide on a deal on this day, it is supposed to be very auspicious. And of course, nowadays, people also observe the Lakshmi Puja by closing a lot of deals on Flipkart and Amazon. But there's much more to Lakshmi Puja than merely acquiring gifts and stuff. This is just to show you the elaborate rangolis or the kolams or the designs that people make on Lakshmi Puja, which is a very creative opportunity for people. Of course, the Lakshmi Puja is followed by the generous display of fireworks. We know that there are a lot of concerns about pollution and both air pollution and noise pollution. I'll let Dr. Anand deal about that. The day four is Balipadyami. Balipadyami is a very interesting festival because it is celebrated in different ways in different parts of India. The most classical description of Balipadyami is the celebration of the reign of Mahabali over his kingdom, because he was a very powerful king. He ran a very peaceful and prosperous kingdom. His subjects were very happy with him. There was never any discrimination in his kingdom. There was no dearth of resources or opportunities. So he was much loved by his subjects. But why did such a lovable person actually get pushed to the netherworld by Vishnu or Vamana? So Bali was a very great king, but he also was a little egoistic about it. And also he was ambitious to get more and more kingdoms under his reign. And actually he craved for the seat of Indra himself. So this kind of unrivaled ambition, which could not be quenched with any amount of victories, probably led to his downfall. So we know that ego is destructive, but spiritual ego is even more destructive. So Bali was pushed to the netherworld, and he got separated from his beloved subjects. But because Bali kept his word to Vishnu or Vamana that he will honor his commitment of giving him 3 steps of land, Vishnu was very happy with him and gave him the opportunity to visit back his kingdom once a year, that is on the Bali Padyami. So to commemorate the greatness of Bali, many some households create what is called as the Balindra Kote or Balindra's Fort, which exists in the netherworld. And this fort is usually made on the floor with cow dung, or if cow dung is not available, people also use ragi and rice paste. It is mainly symbolic of recreating the fort of Bali and doing puja to it along with his wife Vindhyavati. So this is a picture from my own home where we have the cow dung balls placed at the doorstep. And then the marigold is a very common flower used for this festival. It is a traditional festival. And then in the morning, the puja is done to the Balindra's fort, to Bali and his wife Vindhyavati. In the evening, there is a special ritual. Bali, though he wanted to visit his kingdom, he felt worried about leaving his own fort in the netherworld unattended. So Krishna offered to guard it for him and gave him a period of 3.5 hours to go back to his kingdom on the earth and visit his subjects. So in the evening, puja is done to Krishna. And you can see here, my mother-in-law is actually sprinkling milk over the fort. This is called Harina Hole, like water flowed like, milk flowed like a river, because the subjects of Bali in the netherworld were so happy to have Krishna amongst them that they poured milk for him like a river. So this is symbolic of that belief. So in some places on the Padyami, people do the Govardhan Puja. So Govardhan Puja commemorates the lifting of the Govardhan mountain by Krishna to protect the people of Vrindavan from the wrath of Indra. And people make images of Krishna or the Govardhan Parvat using cow dung again on the floor, and that is worshipped. ISKCON temple celebrates this Padyami in a very interesting way. This is the Annakuta celebration. In the center, you can see a mound of food actually made of Anna, and Kuta is mountain. So Annakuta celebration is making a mountain-like mound of food, and then you have the huge variety of sweetmeats and snacks and eatables that are offered to Krishna as prasad, and obviously everybody partakes of the variety of the prasads later. So sometimes they are supposed to have a minimum of 56 varieties of dishes, but this looks like 560, I think. In northern Karnataka, there's another interesting way of celebrating the Padyami. They call it as a Diwali fort making or Diwali khila making, which is actually run as a competition sometimes, where children make forts out of mud and clay and thermocol and sand and whatnot. And Shivaji, interestingly, is a part of this celebration. And these forts are also called as Shivaji's forts. So this is a kind of amalgamation of the current trends and the new scenarios that have emerged over the years. Some parts of Tamil Nadu also celebrate the Padyami as a Kedara Gauri Vrata, where Shiva and Parvati merge as the Ardhanarishwara. I'll not go into that story, but just to mention that this is another puja that is done on the same day. So you can see that different parts of India celebrate this festival in different ways. I'm sure in the audience we have many other people who may add to the variety in the manner of celebration. The last day of Diwali is the Yama Dvitiya. Dvitiya meaning the second day of the Kartika Masa. This day is related to the legend of Yama and Yamuna. As some of you are aware, Yama and Yamuna are twin siblings of Surya. So it so happens that Yama has been sent away to the Yamaloka and separated from Yamuna, and she longs to be reunited with her brother. So at last, when it so happens, Yamuna is so happy that she holds a big celebration to to share her joy and welcome her brother into her home again. So Yamuna Dvitiya is a celebration of the love, devotion and trust of a sister in her brother. So in many parts of India, this is called as Bhai Dooj or Bhaiya Dooj. In Andhra, they call it as Bhagini Hasta Bhojanam or Vidiya Bhojanam. Bhagini is sister, and basically this day is devoted to when a sister serves her brother food cooked by her own hands, which is the Hasta. So in northern India, day observation of this day is characterized by a very important ceremony called Tika Lagana. Tika Lagana, like the tilak has to be put by the sister on the brother's forehead. So this is a very important thing, and it's such an important festival because even this festival starts right in the childhood of the brother sister, and they grow into this tradition over the years, and it continues even after the sister gets married and goes to her in-laws' place. So it's a wonderful tradition because in many places, especially in the olden days, when the girl goes away to her husband's place, the brother would not be able to visit her for many months or maybe even years. But this festival kind of made it possible for a brother to visit his sister every year. Now we think that it's no longer the olden days, we're in the modern age where a brother can visit his sister any day. But unfortunately, even now, brothers and sisters may not be separated by tradition, but they're separated by the many kilometers because they brother and sister live in different countries or different places, and it's very difficult for them to visit each other. So if brothers and sisters are able to visit each other on this day, they're very fortunate, and I envy them sometimes. So the sister makes a very nice festive meal for the brother, and this is a traditional meal which is composed of the kosambari or the salads, the cut fruit, then you have the puliyogre and the rice and the dal and the payasam. So these are all the traditional aspects of a festive meal. So lastly, the Uttana Dwadashi or the Tulasi Vivaha, though it is not a strictly a part of Diwali, sometimes it is celebrated on the 12th day of the month. I think here Vishnu is married to Tulasi, that is what is called as Tulasi Vivaha. Symbolically, we do this as the puja of the twig of Amla with the Tulasi plant. So I'll stop here so that we can have time for discussion in the later part. Now, I wish you all a very safe and happy Diwali. And I request Dr. Anantadhyam to take over and talk about current concerns and challenges in the celebration of Diwali. Thank you.
It's somewhat unfortunate that I'll have to be the dampener for this festive season, but being a time of introspection, I think this is a good time to ask these questions, because of late, Diwali has been in the news for a lot of wrong reasons as well. So, when we think about Diwali celebrations, this is largely what we would think about. Lamps, fireworks, you know, family gathering, good food and presents. And unfortunately, there is a flip side to that as well, which is these. As a doctor and as somebody who's worked in the burns ward, you know, this is perhaps the most tragic one, the time of the year when burns are on the rise. Unfortunately, a lot of the victims are children, and sometimes they even lose sight. So this is a big safety concern. Another concern that has sort of been doing the rounds in the more recent years is the effect that fireworks and crackers have on animals, because unlike humans, their hearing is much more acute than ours. So even noises that we would not consider as dangerously high, for them it is extremely terrifying. So animal rights is something that again is brought into question. Pollution is what has sort of pushed Diwali into the headlines. Those of you who have been following the news would be aware that this year, several state governments have said that they're going to be banning fireworks altogether over concerns of pollution. And this is a very interesting question. We'll sort of be looking at it a little later, because there are many who say that, you know, Diwali is not the problem. The problem is somewhere else. Diwali is sort of just one very small part of it. But whatever it is, the pollution at that time is a cause of concern. primarily for people who are suffering from other illnesses, respiratory and cardiac illnesses. Asthmatics would be very familiar with this. It's, you know, if you're like me, an asthmatic, then going out during Diwali is quite a scary experience. And then, of course, I'm sure we have all learned this as children, the production of fireworks is not the safest of processes. There's involvement of a lot of dangerous chemicals. So people question the ethical nature of consumption of fireworks because people producing them are often working with extremely dangerous chemicals without adequate protection. So if you're buying fireworks, you're encouraging that practice. But it's not as simple as that. You know, we spoke about pollution, and the question is, how much of the pollution problem is because of Diwali? There's a very interesting study, in fact, two, one which was conducted in Delhi and another in Jamshedpur, which threw up unexpected results. One, it said that, yes, there is a significant spike in pollution during Diwali, but it is not as large as would be expected. And if you're looking at pollution over the entire year, it's not a very, very big rise. And it says that one of the contributing factors to this rise in pollution might actually be an increased vehicular traffic because there are more people moving around at this time than at other times. So it's not the answer to pollution may not simply lie in banning fireworks during Diwali. The dangerous levels of pollution exist even at other times. Diwali is something that just worsens it. So there is a lot of debate about, you know, how effective banning fireworks is going to be. This time around, given that, you know, the economy is rather shaky, many of the firework manufacturers have brought out this problem. They say that because of the green Diwali phenomenon where people are opting out of fireworks, the people who are involved in producing these are losing a lot of income because people are not buying fireworks anymore. And firework production has traditionally been a community affair. So entire communities have been involved in producing fireworks. And because of the pandemic, since other festivals have also been very low-key, firework consumption has been low. And so entire communities have faced loss of work and loss of income. So that is a concern that, you know, we cannot ignore. Health concerns, of course, is a very big thing. As I said, asthmatics, those with respiratory diseases, those with heart problems, already have an issue. Another category of people who often don't receive much attention is those suffering from disorders like anxiety, for whom these loud noises and you know, the explosions and things are very traumatic. And then being in 2020, you know, not bringing COVID into this would be leaving out a very big thing. COVID, unfortunately, has you know, even put into question practices that were previously thought to be harmless, like gathering of family members. You know, now that is also a big question mark. So, I mean, where do we strike the balance? We cannot tell people don't celebrate Diwali, you know, don't gather, because for many, this is the one time of the year that you're able to gather. At the same time, you know, the pandemic is not gone, and the pandemic certainly isn't going to say, well, today is a festival, so I'm going to ease off and I'll come back tomorrow. So where do we strike a balance? And those of you who have been following the news, again, would be aware of this new phenomenon called green fireworks. This was developed in India. It's got a lot of new technology added in. The chemicals used are different, and it's shown to be less polluting than the regular fireworks, about 30% less. But is 30% too little, too late? We still have 70%, and when we are already well above the permissible limits for air pollutants, is 30% enough, is the question. When this went to court and there was a debate about, you know, is a ban on fireworks permissible, the question arose of about whether fireworks is an integral part of Diwali, whether it is an essential part of Diwali without which the festival cannot be celebrated. As we have seen previous panelists speak about it, you know, there are people who would say, no, it's not really the most essential. But there are others who would say that for me, it is the most essential. And then the question arises, who gets to decide what is essential and what is not? And of course, the final point that I would like to sort of raise here is, this is something that I've heard a lot of people say, that, you know, we don't burst crackers, but we use fireworks that produce a lot of color and light, you know, the rockets and the flower pots and so on. So is it a safer option? Because noise pollution is less, sure, but is it, you know, a safer option? So this point in particular, I would like to dwell on, because the production of these colorful fireworks is very interesting. These colors are produced by metal salts. I'm sure at least some of us here who did chemistry in 11th and 12th, we've done this where we heat specific salts, and based on the color that we get, you say, okay, it's a compound of this element. So as we can see here, red is produced by lithium. The silver comes from aluminium, titanium, and magnesium. Strontium is used for purple and copper for blue. Sodium produces that brilliant golden yellow. Barium produces green, and calcium also produces a sort of a yellow, a deeper shade of yellow. And you can mix these salts in different proportions to get different colors. Unfortunately, not all of these salts are safe. Copper salts, for instance, are notorious for worsening respiratory problems. And strontium is an element which, even at the best of times, has always got a small amount of radioactive substance involved in it. So there is always the association with radioactivity. Similarly, barium in large quantities and as specific compounds is known to be carcinogenic, which means it can produce cancers. And titanium, magnesium, and aluminium have their own toxicity associated as well. So it's not that, you know, it is less polluting. It may not make the same amount of noise, but it certainly does add substances into the atmosphere that are more toxic than the average cracker or average non-colored firework would be. So it's not really a safer option as such. So, well, I've thrown out a lot of questions. What are the answers to those questions? Well, I don't have the answer to all of them, but there are some answers that do come to my mind. I am a firm believer in Green Diwali. Yeah, it has produced some unfortunate consequences like loss of income. But if anything has been learned from the green firework experiment, it is that if you lay enough emphasis on a problem, the key stakeholders in that, including firecracker manufacturers, will put in the time, the effort, and the money to come up with viable solutions. If we keep saying that, you know, firecracker manufacturers are going to make a loss and so I'm going to buy fireworks, there is no incentive, there is no push to arrive at an ecologically sustainable answer. So only I believe that, you know, this is something that we have to do in order to go forward. Otherwise, this problem of pollution isn't going to go away. And at some point, we are going to reach a stage where it's too late to do anything about it. But if you're not convinced by that argument and you still wish to go ahead with the use of fireworks, please select a place and time carefully. Roads are convenient places. Unfortunately, they're also places where bystanders are most likely to be hurt. And you know, choosing a time when commuter traffic is at its worst is not very helpful. So please select a place that's secluded, where people are unlikely to walk in, you know, without warning. Ensure that if you are doing it in a public place, you have somebody warning people that, you know, we have just lit a firework, so please watch where you're going. And choose a time when it's not, the place is not very crowded. Choose the safest type of firework. This has been a problem over the years. This year it's likely to be a little less because of the political situation, but cheap Chinese fireworks tend to gut the market this time of the year. And they're made with less, fewer precautions in place. So the green firework label might be abused by companies to push still dangerous fireworks. So do be careful when you're selecting your fireworks. Do check out where they come from and whether they are what they claim to be. Be mindful at all times. You know, it's not that accidents happen only with fireworks. We've had a lot of instances of people coming to the burns ward after, you know, their clothes have accidentally caught fire, brushing against lamps or so on. So please be mindful that, you know, there's fire everywhere and you've got to be careful around it. And given that this is in the midst of a pandemic, please follow all the safety measures for the pandemic. I know that after 7-8 months of this, we are all tired of the isolation. We are all tired of the masks. You know, we really crave for company of loved ones. But please do pay heed to the fact that there is a pandemic raging as well. So take adequate measures for that. And this has not been an exhaustive list of solutions. There are more questions out there. And since this is a time of introspection, it's good as any other to think about these issues as well and try to find solutions to these. So that's all from me. Thank you and have a safe Diwali. Please do think of what the way forward for us is. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Anna. Now, before we move on to the final panelist, in fact, we had requested Dr. Sitara to sum up on all the perspectives we had till now, along with even a couple of what the participants here feel, and then take it up as a way forward part. So I think we can now open for question and answers. So I think I'll just read out if there are any questions. I will begin with a couple of sharings too. I think Ms. Manjula Raghuram shares that it is very interesting to learn the different ways Deepavali is celebrated across the country. Now, this festival not only dispels light and ushers happiness, but brings out creativity in the family. Arrangement of diyas, akash butti, flower arrangements, preparing sweets, lighting fireworks, all these brings a family together, which is very important in these days. Now, I think there was also, I think we'll go move on to a question by Ms. Madam Sujata. I think she initially shared that the symbolism was very interesting to know. And there is this question to Dr. Sridevi. Explain the Trivikrama and who is the husband of Tulasi?
Trivikrama, the term refers to Vamana. As we know, the legend says that Vamana requested for three steps of land from Mahabali. So three Vikrama is the three steps, and but later on the three steps turned out to be three gigantic steps because Vamana attained his Virata form, the huge form. That is the understanding behind the term Trivikrama. So Trivikrama basically refers to Vamana, which is an incarnation of Vishnu, Tulsi and Vishnu, we already are aware that Vishnu is the husband of Tulsi, and the Tulsi Puja or the Uttana Dwadashi, which we celebrate, is a day when Vishnu and Tulsi, Krishna and Tulsi stay together for one day. Tulsi is actually symbolic of detachment, they say. So Krishna or Vishnu, the Vishnu principle, people who want to attain the Lord, attain him better through detachment rather than through the aspirations, greed and wants. So that is the relationship between Vishnu and Tulsi. It is the element of detachment which gets you what you want.
Thank you, ma'am. So, I think we have Mr. Ramesh Venkatraman. I think he would like to make a comment and also answer a question. Sorry, ask a question here at this point. Yeah.
Thank you. I just wanted to address the one point about about firecrackers and the issue of culture. I think too often I think we're led by the political expediency of the day rather than by about the culture. Now, it's often, the story is told that, firecrackers have never been a part of culture. But if you actually run through history, the first, recorded instance of firecrackers used as part of Deepavali dates back to roughly about 1400 AD, which is the Vijayanagara Empire. And it's recorded by an Italian traveler, and he describes fireworks in the reign of King Devaraya II. There's also a book called the Katuka Chintamani, which is a Sanskrit volume. This is in Orissa by Gajapati Pratapa Rudradeva, again 1497 to 1539, where he discusses how firecrackers need to be made. So this, there is the story that, it is the Chinese. Maybe the technology came from there, but, there has been at least a 700, 800 year history of fire. Then there is also closer home, Bijapur, 1600 AD somewhere. Ibrahim Adil Shah, the Sultan of Bijapur, spent approximately 80,000 rupees only on firecrackers for his daughter's wedding those days, 400 years ago. And if you look at Saint Eknath in his book, Rukmini Swayamvara, he mentions a range of fireworks, and one of them he mentions is the Fuljadi, which is still something that we have. And the oldest reference to the use of firecrackers using this is in the Arthashastra, where it's called the Agni Churna, which is to distract the enemy. So that's the one point. The second point, I also wanted to talk about is the fact that, I talked about political expediency. I think what is happening is that, we seem to be missing the woods for the trees quite often. If you look at how much of, what happens during Diwali is a momentary spike. But if you look at the real problem, 51% of all pollution comes from industrial and construction work, 27% from vehicles, 17% from crop burning and waste burning, and less than 5% from the firecrackers. Now, there are 500,000 people who are employed in the firecracker industry in Sivakasi alone. So, have we found a solution? I think none of the, most of them have already suffered big time because of demonetization and subsequently because of the, the issues that have come up as a result of the COVID-related pandemic. So, none of them, we have not found a solution, but we are only looking at addressing a problem. We are looking at, addressing only the low-hanging fruit. So how are we going to be looking at, we continue to burn, 60% of our electricity comes from burning, thermal power plants, which, are polluting. One person drives a car. There's so much pollution that comes from vehicular emissions. But we don't want to address any of those things. I understand that, cars are getting more efficient and all of that, but still. We want to take up only, and the whole argument is that culture is always upstream from politics. Politics is always downstream from culture. And when you say that culture is upstream, what we're saying is that why is it that people come onto the streets or come into the open on particular days is precisely because of this. If you look at why do Jews, wail before the wall, or why is a Muharram celebrated like that, or what is anything done is only to show it's a cultural marker for a particular community to say that our presence is being marked on a particular day. I think taking away all of these cultural markers also takes away from the civilizational heritage that most people have. I'm sure many people will differ with me, but these are my points. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Ramesh. So I think if there are No more questions. I think we'll now look forward to hearing from Dr. Sitaram on his views on discussion so far and also how we can reflect and act on these aspects in our future celebrations. Over to you, sir.
Very happy Deepavali to all the participants. And thank you all the panelists for a fantastic presentation. It made things very, very interesting. So I'm sure all the participants would have relived their childhood memories. I, for one, enjoyed Deepavali a great deal, and I'm sure the memories come flooding of the early morning crackers or the Abhyanga and such stuff. And it's very important that the children of today are not cheated out of these fantastic experiences, which actually last a lifetime. What we saw now over the 1 hour, we went through what is Deepavali. We also learned why is Deepavali. Why is Deepavali celebrated? What is the symbolism? And then what are the various ways in which Deepavali is celebrated? So how? So why, what, how? But equally importantly, I feel it was important to understand how not. Because Krishna in his Bhagavad Gita also says that karma is important, but we should also know vikarma and akarma. That is how not to do certain things. So in that context, I'm sure the presentation by Dr. Anant brought to light certain concerns and challenges that exist, particularly in this particular moment, this particular juncture, where we have to exercise caution. But that caution has to be very correctly exercised. India has been sort of a mixture of years and years of experience, very rich traditions, and a land where mythology sort of merges seamlessly into history. So what is history, what is not, or what is just a legend and a mythology or a myth is rather difficult to differentiate. And that is true even around the stories that we heard now about Deepavali. And as these stories are handed down generations, who doesn't love a story? You know, when I'm told a story, I'd like to tell somebody else the same story, but add my masala to it and make it more interesting in my way and maybe more colorful in my own way and then pass it on. But what is really remarkable is that thousands of years of this generational handing down of these stories, millions of stories with zillions of modifications, the fantastic thing I believe is that the essence is not lost. And that essence is that it is the triumph of goodness over evil. And that goodness and evil both exist, both coexist, not outside, but within. And these are times for us to reflect on the balance that we can strike within of the goodness and the evil that resides in each one of us. The stories of Naraka as well as Bali tell us that basically they were very good people and great achievers. They were very learned scholars. They were great warriors. They were very powerful. But then, even into this, and in fact, they were great devotees of Vishnu as well. But then, even into this supposedly good mind, there did enter certain vicious thoughts. The Mura of the Narakasura story is probably symbolic of what can happen to even a well-intentioned individual if the right sort of sangha, right sort of company is not ensured. So over a period of time, Naraka as well as Bali progressively gave up all the good that they had accumulated, and with just that one single desire that came in, progressively went into a progressive degradation that led to a precipitous fall. But then with repentance, there is always hope, and like was highlighted by Bhargavi, we are not celebrating Bali Padyami as Vamana Padyami. We are still calling it Bali Padyami, and Naraka Chaturdashi is still Naraka Chaturdashi. So we know that with proper internal modifications, with that evolution, even a person who is now treading the wrong path can come back, and that goodness has to be celebrated. So we are celebrating that goodness. We are celebrating that victory within righteous path, the righteous thoughts over the negative influences that come up. You know, as we look at history as well as mythology, like was very correctly pointed out by Ramesh, the history of India, as we look back, has been rich with a lot of references to fireworks in multiple ways, be it in warfare or be it in peacetime. There are many 14th century, 15th century paintings which depict this sort of use of firecrackers. And the reference that Ramesh mentioned about the Vijayanagar Empire and then the Bijapur kings, they are very valid, they're very true. And so this is where, like I was saying, mythology sort of merges with history. So let's not give in to the idea that firecrackers in India came only after Shivakasi brought up its factories. No, that's not true. So we have been having these firecrackers. We have been having this culture of celebrating Deepavali in certain ways, and that includes the use of firecrackers. But having said that, it's also a time for the right sort of introspection. There are multiple ways in which we have been celebrating Deepavali. And like Dr. Sridevi very rightly pointed out, firecrackers do form an important part of Deepavali, but they are not the whole and soul of Deepavali. Maybe there is a need now to sort of relook at what of these multiple ways of celebrating Deepavali can be given a greater precedence or a greater prioritization. And in this particular moment of the raging pandemic, perhaps the dangerous part, the dangerous types of firecrackers can be used much less, but let us look at the other areas of celebrating the Deepavali. There are multiple challenges, no doubt, given these restrictions that are imposed and the respiratory illness concerns that exist. But then there are some practical ways that Anant also pointed out. We could definitely try them out. This has sort of been the catchword. One of the catchwords of late has been social distancing. And I, for one, have been a very, very strong critic of that word. I'd rather use safe distancing or physical distancing. Socially, this is the time actually to get stronger together. It's important that we bond more strongly than earlier. So let us make sure that this Deepavali, we do stay away, we do stay safe, but then bond with each other socially, with each other, in spirit. So the relationship needs to be strengthened, and that relationship strengthening is what is promoted by various cultural practices that were described. Challenges or not, I think we as a community, not just in India, but globally, need to regroup, and part of introspection should be of how our own behavior, individually and collectively, is taking us towards further challenges rather than towards solutions. There are various problems, but then solutions as well, and we need to understand and approach it in a very balanced way. I'd like to end with what Swami Vivekananda spoke in his lecture in Chicago in the World Parliament of Religions. We are all very familiar with his first speech and his first words, the address to the gathering as sisters and brothers of America is something that's very often quoted. But I'd like to again remind that Swamiji actually gave 7 lectures in those few days. And his final words in the 7th lecture are actually extremely relevant for today. And I'd like to quote that at this juncture. In the last part of his 7th lecture, Swamiji says that what we need now is help and not fight, assimilation and not destruction, and harmony and peace and not dissension. So this is a time for reflection individually as well as collectively, and action oriented towards ensuring that we help each other and not fight each other. We assimilate the knowledge, we assimilate the strength and not lead each other towards destruction, and work towards peace and harmony and not towards differences. So let this Deepavali bring in that spirit of oneness in all of us, that spirit of togetherness in all of us, and lead us from darkness towards light. I wish you all a very happy Deepavali. Culture, I always believe, is a dynamic process. You know, it we inherit certain practices, we refine them, and then further we hand it over to the coming generations. And that contextualization has to be done in a very, very responsible and meaningful way. So let us all introspect and contribute our might to making sure that these traditions are preserved, protected, promoted, and then handed over. A happy Deepavali to all of you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. I think that also answers Madam Padmaja's question on what is the difference between culture and tradition. I think sir just ended his talk with that. Sharings, I'll just give another half a minute. Ms. Radhika Srinivas shares that she's glad that this perspective was brought in, which gets usually lost in the gross glamour. So thank you. Yeah. So I think with that, we come to the end of this session. I would like to especially thank all the speakers for giving us such an insightful information, which was in fact added by the views of a couple of enthusiastic participants. So, and I would like to again especially thank many of you who have been participating in all our webinars. So from all of us at the hosting end, may the divine light of Diwali Diyas spread peace, happiness, prosperity and good health to all of you. So once again, wishing a very happy Diwali and Shubh Ratri to all of you.